I just want to say thank you on behalf of Lisa and family. Thank you for being here to support her through the passing of Rick and to celebrate Rick Keeton's life. So thank you for being here. It's a big Parks family for sure, a lot of other family and friends around. Lisa, these tables are mostly full all the way through this shelter, and this is one of the shelters that Rick would help clean once in a while back in his day for sure. Some of these pictures prove it. There's a picture of the right center where he's sweeping up the curb lines of City Park ball fields. And that's something where, that's the first time I met him, was push brooming curb lines of City Park ball fields, cleaning up underneath the bleachers, and getting those ball fields ready for play that evening. So, and the first time I met him was in 1990 when I was an hourly working here when he walked in the shop. So I'm going to start out by reading the obituary. And the obituary was actually put out by, I think, Brenda. I think you helped Lisa get this. I think Lisa and Brenda worked on this together. So this obituary can be found on Go's Funeral Care website. And by the way, on this, on that obituary, there's a great link to a video, a YouTube video, where these two were recognized in an award-winning video through Larimer County. It's an incredible video to watch. I think it's 8 minutes, if I remember correctly. And it's a video that we shared amongst each other internally at the Parks Department to kind of showcase Rick and Lisa and some of the amazing abilities that Rick had in the world. So Richard Rick Keeton, 65, of Fort Collins, passed away on May 30th, 2021. Rick was a native Coloradoan, born and raised in the area. He graduated from Fort Collins High School and also attended college in the area. He was very good with technology. And after college, he began working in the city of Fort Collins as a maintenance person, but also as a data entry technician. Rick's use of technology was woven in many, many parts of his life, including his communication. He lived with cerebral palsy that affected his ability to speak, so he spoke up using an electronic communication device. He used several models and versions of this device throughout the years and advocated for other individuals living with disabilities. He tried to speak up for those who couldn't speak for themselves. Rick was something of a local celebrity, speaking to audiences about his life, winning several awards, helping speech therapists learn to work with people using the technology that was so much help to him. In 2004, Rick met Lisa Wallace as they were both commuting to work on the same dial-a-ride bus. On June 24th, 2005, the pair were married and began their lives together. Rick knew before Lisa did at that moment that they were meant to be together. It took a few months for Rick to figure out what was going on. Typical guy, right? That's how it works. We're kind of just lopey-dopey walking around. So Rick enjoyed listening to CB radio, loved working outside, gardening, and doing yard work. He was always willing to lend a hand and was skilled with irrigation systems. Folks who worked with him in the Parks Department said he did a lot of work beyond the data tech position. And those of us that have been around a long time definitely saw that in action and can attest to that. Rick also loved to swim, and he was best at the backstroke. In the 1970s, he helped start the SLICE adaptive swim program at CSU. Rick is survived by his loving wife, Lisa Keeton, sister, Becky Adams, nieces, Heather Stewart and Marie Adams, nephews, Tim Adams and Mike Adams Jr., and so many friends of the community, and especially in the Parks Department. And then at the bottom, it's in lieu of flowers, please donate to the Rick D. Keeton Memorial Fund in care of Go's Funeral Care. We'll talk a little bit more about that afterwards. So right now we're going to, before I turn it over to our first speaker, Mike Calhoun, longtime friend and co-worker, we will play a song that, in Lisa's words, was, this is the way Rick wanted to live his life. So this is by Frank Sinatra, My Way.
The end is near, and so I face the final curtain. My friend, I'll say it clear, I'll state my case, of which I'm certain. I've lived a life that's full, I traveled each and every highway and more, much more than this. I did it my way. Regrets, I've had a few, but then again, too few to mention. I did what I had to do, saw it through without exemption. I planned each charted course, each careful step along the byway, and more, much more than this, I did it my way. Yes, there were times, I'm sure you knew, when I bit off more than I could chew. But through it all, when there was doubt, I ate it up and spit it out. I faced it all and I stood tall and did it my way. I've loved, I've laughed and cried, I've had my fill, my share of losing, and now, as tears subside, I find it all so amusing to think I did all that, and may I say, not in a shy way, oh no, oh no, not me, I did it my way. For what is a man, what has he got, if not himself?
We can figure out why Lisa chose to play that. So I'll hand the mic over to Mike Calhoun, like I said, longtime friend and coworker.
Thanks, Scott. Afternoon, everybody. Thank you all for being here. This is really special to be able to pay a tribute to Rick and join us in the celebration of life for Rick. And like Kevin said, on behalf of Lisa and her family, we're really honored that you all have come out here to share some stories, take some big deep breaths, and keep doing it Rick's way. So that's what it comes down to. So Rick started with the city. Well, let me back up. My name's Mike Calhoun. I'm the Parks Department Director, and I've worked my whole career with Rick Keeton. He started a little earlier than I did. He started in 1973, which I couldn't find in the records, but I remember him saying that in an interview that he gave years ago, that he started in 1973. This time of year is when the Parks Department is really getting going and ramping up, and we're usually preparing for the 4th of July, and Rick's least favorite day of the year, which was the 5th of July. He hated the 5th of July. He hated cleaning up after everybody, but it's part of the job. We had to do it, and he was proud of what it looked like whenever we were all done. We had a stretch of birthdays. Rick and I shared birthdays that were real close to each other. We have 5 days in a row, starting with mine on the 8th of July. Ralph Zentz is the assistant city forester. He's on the 9th of July. Rick's is on the 10th of July. Ralph's son, Jared, is on the 11th of July. And Angela Pena, one of our other employees, is on the 12th of July. So we have like birthday after birthday after birthday. And we'd walk in and wish each other happy birthday for a week, is what it came down to, is how we played the game. So when I was thinking about today, over the weekend, I was thinking about words that remind me of Rick. Words like perseverance and commitment, fun-loving, that smile right there, hard-working, humble, compassionate. And I always thought of Rick as a teacher. And probably the word that he wouldn't like me to use, but I say heroic. You know, he would not like that, because he felt like he was just doing what he had to do, you know, to communicate, to live. And I saw it every time. It was tough on me coming into the shop some days, and I'd see Rick. And he gave me the gift of perspective. You know, he snapped me right back in, like, hey, it's okay, get up, let's go. You know, we can make it. Rick did it every day, I can do it every day. So, you know, you all know the challenges that he lived with cerebral palsy throughout his life. And I remember the first time I heard his story about when he was 14 and he had that breakout moment, that breakthrough moment where he started communicating and people started listening to Rick. And they found out that there's a person inside that really was intelligent and wanted to contribute and be part of people's lives. And it was just an amazing story, that what he went through, and then the fact that he would take it and pay it forward, you know, using those speech output devices that he started learning how to work with, and then going out and teaching people how to use those devices and giving of himself in that way, in that selfless way. It was just absolutely amazing and so admirable. And then when he found Lisa and he gets married in 2005, what a beautiful moment in everybody's lives. And Lisa, this is what I'm going to stop and just tell you, like I've told you before, that if there's anything that you need, we're here. You're part of the Parks family, and you'll always be part of the Parks family. So I guess what it comes down to is being an old Irish Catholic altar boy from way back, the best way that I think I want to remember Rick is with a toast. So if you got one, raise it. So I just want to say, you know, I want to toast Rick Keeton, my friend. You know, in my mind, in my eye, I can see you running, jumping, and kicking your heels up really high while you're celebrating the life that you have lived so well. That's how, you know, I'll always remember you in my heart. Love you, man. Here you go.
All right.
on, Mikey. That's a good toast. All right, so Leanne, if you're ready, we'll get close to number two here. Okay, so the next song that Lisa wanted to put was When You Wish Upon a Star. Now, I asked why that one, and you know, what comes to mind for that song. What she said was Rick's positive belief in everything coming true, that things are going to be okay, and things are going to come true. So, When You Wish Upon a Star. So When You Wish Upon a Star. Again, Lisa, that makes perfect sense for that song being chosen for this day. All right, so now this is a time for any of us who want to share a story. I mean, a lot of us worked with them for decades, and a lot of them knew them longer than that. But if anybody would like to share stories about them, I'll start with one. I mean, and again, it's a testament to his amazing ability through his disability. So the first time I communicated with him, he had a Ouija board, right? So the different communication devices throughout his life that were the utmost of technology, the first time I met him, he was using a Ouija board. And of course, as a 19-year-old kid, I was kind of wigged out by that. Didn't quite know what was going on and why it was being used and what is going on here. It took about 10 minutes for this thick skull to figure out that it was very simple for him to communicate, yes and no. ask again, spell things out for me. And I've told a lot of people this story recently since his passing, but I just love for the rest of the group to hear this. Is I was sitting there and I was intently trying to help, right? Just trying to help him get through what he wanted, because he came to me as a young kid saying, hey, you know, he's pointing to his board, you know, smacking the board, helping, trying to get me to pay attention, right? And he starts spelling it out for me. P-E-P-S. And I was like, whoa, Rick, I can't think of any word, Pete. I can't even think of what you're saying there. Start again. And he looked at me like, strange. And he started again. P-E-P. It took me two or three times before this thick skull, he's just trying to get me to open his Pepsi. When I finally said the word Pepsi, he goes, right? Incredible. And then I spent the next 5 minutes apologizing while I'm getting the Pepsi ready for him, right? So many people throughout his life at work helped him with that Pepsi, right? They helped him with lunch and, you know, why is that? Why are you being so mean, scrunching his burger down like that, your sandwich? You're just smashing that thing. No, trust me, that's what he wants, and that's what he needs, and that's what helps him, right? So, I talked to John Clark earlier today, former city council member, John Clark. We spoke to him a little earlier this afternoon, and he's willing to share a couple words, too, about life with Rick. So, John.
Thank you. Yep. Well, I first had an opportunity to get to know Rick back when he was investigating and becoming a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And in as much as I'm also a member of that church, it was a bond that we had for quite a while through his life. Most recently, I've had an opportunity to work with him and with Lisa and kind of just, we went up the river and we pet a dog, didn't we, Lisa? It was awesome. We've done that a couple times. But my first involvement with Rick was with the board. He didn't have the fancy electronic gear. He would spell things out. And I understand what you're saying. Sometimes I didn't get it. But he was very patient to a point. And we finally get things worked out. Had a great time with Rick when he made a decision to be baptized into our church. It took a couple guys to get him into the water, but we got it done. And it was a great experience. Not too long after that, in 1980, he joined our church in 1980, about February 6th, as I recall. And I was a city council member in 1981 to 85. I got a computer that was hooked up to a very local city only. We didn't have the internet the same we do now. But we had email within the city. I got an email from Rick. And it was so exciting because I didn't have to sit and try and spell, because he's a better speller than I was. And I was able to exchange emails with Rick on the city system until I left office in 85 and they took my computer away. But nonetheless, I've had that blessing of knowing Rick. In our church, we have a system where we go and we have different people that we go and visit with, and we kind of minister to them. Rick was a minister to our son. And even more importantly, our son, who is now Lieutenant Colonel in the Army Reserve, had been deployed, and he spent a year in Iraq and Kuwait. And during that time, Rick would visit with his companion, our daughter-in-law, who was there alone in Wellington. And it was a great blessing to her to have Rick come see her and see how things were going. I just love Rick. He's had such a challenge in life to live with the disabilities that he had. That somehow he didn't know that. He was very, very strong. And as he dealt with those things, I think it's neat to know now that in our faith system, we believe in resurrection. We believe that we will be resurrected to a perfect frame. And these challenges that Rick has had with his speaking and even his locomotion are going to go away. And he's now, I know where he is. He's in paradise. And He's going to be resurrected to a perfect frame when the Savior returns. Thank you. I got to quit because I'm going. I'm struggling.
Okay. Thank you, John. Appreciate that. So more recently, John, I was getting emails from Rick, and he was usually telling me to please check your email and help me with this. I need an answer to this before I can move on. Would you please help me now? So he was very good at that, and he would keep us on track, and he couldn't move on with this project until he got answers from us, and he was a wonderful communicator via email. All right, so next, Dave Mosnick wants to say something. So Dave was at Parks. Were you at Parks when Rick started?
I started in 75, yep. So he was a couple years ahead of me.
Yep, so here comes Dave Mosnick. Come on, Dave.
Thank you.
The moose.
Thank you. My condolences to Lisa and Rick's family. I know you guys have a lot, blessed to know him. You're gonna have a lot of memories to fall back on with Rick. As Kevin said, I started working with Parks and Recreation in 1975 with the Recreation Division, and met Rick way back when. He was involved in not only working for the Parks Department, but he was also involved in a lot of our recreation activities that were at that point in time run by Norm Chong, and then Terry Keith became a really good friend of Rick's, and unfortunately Terry Keith passed away a couple of years ago. But they spent a lot of time together. Not sure what all they did, but anyway, I'm sure it was fun. And I think both of them learned a lot from it. But you know, Rick, from the day I met him, the smile, as Mike said over there, I mean, it was instantaneous. It was part of Rick, part of his personality. And you know what? Rick never was afraid to take on any challenges, whether it was learning to play, learning to swim. I can remember talking to people at Fort Collins High School when I first got here, and them telling me about Rick starting to learn how to communicate by taking a newspaper and picking words out of a newspaper. You know, how many people can do that? That is amazing in itself. And then he also then started, that's when I think they started getting him into swimming and also some weight training in the weight room. And I never knew Rick ever complain about anything. And you know, I look at Rick as he made the best of his abilities. It didn't matter if the disability wasn't even part of his vocabulary. He just went on and he did whatever he could to perform. And you can look at all throughout the time that as Rick matured and all the different tasks and stuff he did with Parks and where he ended up later on with Kevin called the Ouija board, and then it got more sophisticated and get new one, and it was better than the first one. And then when he got into computers, I mean, holy cow, the world was wide open to him, and he took every advantage of it. And there's no doubt that he was able to master the use of the computers and do stuff that I'll never be able to, and there's a lot of people in here probably the same way. But bottom line, Rick was just a nice, nice individual. And he was fun to be around. And he just brought the best out in people. And I know there's gonna be a lot of people miss Rick, but there's a lot of people benefited from his friendship and his kindness. So I'll leave it at that.
Yeah, Moose. Thank you, Moose.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Hello. So I am from Mexico. And when I met my husband, John Wallace, Lisa Wallace, I had in Mexico 10 brothers and sisters, right in five. And the house was so big. In a Mexican style. Pero we talk to Lisa very, very late. And she was happy with all my brothers and sisters. And all of them, they want to go with her. And we have fun all the time with Lisa. She was so chiquita, chiquita, chiquita. She can speak Spanish pretty well because she learned. And she was so happy in the big house, Mexican house. And we loved her. My brothers and sisters, they are sad because she is lonely, but she is not lonely. She has all of us, right? Yeah. And then, I was so happy to be here with his father, to be here. We sorry too much, but we are always with everybody. Thank you, Lisa. Thank you. Thank you.
Yep. All right, next up we'll bring up John Hawkins. He's a CSU swimming program and a CP coach for 1 year with Rick. So, John Hawkins.
Thank you. Is this good right here?
More,
yeah. Okay. I wasn't prepared to speak, but I think it's important. I met Rick in the 70s, the late 70s. I was a student at CSU. That's 40-some years ago. And yes, I'm nearing retirement. I was about the same age as Rick, so... You know, that says something about how long ago I knew him. I've lost track of Rick over the last 10 or 15 years. I didn't know he was married. I've been thinking about him for the last month or so. And rarely, but I did look in the paper and I saw that this was happening yesterday. And I thought it was important to come to honor Rick. And I think it's also important for me to share with you what I know about or what I experienced with him. And I think it's really important for me when I think about Rick, I think about somebody that had a strong sense of purpose. And he was so dedicated to swimming. And I can't think of a more fit person than Rick. Muscular, strong, and you know, I never heard him say, I can't do something. He might look at you like, are you crazy? But generally, Rick would try and he would do things. And if he didn't do it, he would try again. And that's what I think about Rick, his strong sense of purpose and his strong sense of right and wrong. And so we're probably both 20-somethings back then. Rick would be in the program, there'd be 20 or 30 students that were in the program, maybe for good reasons, maybe they were just trying to get their resume to look good. But after about half a semester at that program where you're teaching people to swim that might be blind, they might be deaf, they might have autistic spectrum things, who knows? Maybe they have physical disabilities. It wouldn't matter because you would see students transform from doing something because they should or ought to doing it because they loved it. And one thing that Rick did, so I'm just a student participating in this program. I did it for 10 years. I graduated, I stayed at CSU, I got a job there. Rick did it for 10 or 15 years. So. One thing that I think about, and I don't know if anybody here was in that program, please tap me on the shoulder later and let's talk. But I can remember Rick had such an impression on the students. He taught them so much, and I wish if they knew that this celebration of life was here, they're probably all over the planet right now. There are hundreds of students that Rick touched their lives that were part of that program. That may have just spent one semester, maybe 1 year. They may have stayed the whole 4 years. And it would be hundreds of students that he touched their lives and made a huge impact on the world and a huge impact on their experience at CSU. You can't pay for that. The other thing was, so Rick, I mean, he just really had a great sense of purpose and very dedicated. And I think that rubbed off. And I think it's such a big deal. They learned more about life during that program than probably the 4 years of education in a classroom. The other thing was we went, so 1 year Rick had me, I coached him over at the Fort Collins Club, and we'd meet about two or three times a week and practice swimming. and he worked on his backstroke. And I can't remember when it was, but it had to be 15 or 20 years ago. And we went to the Paralympics, the CP Olympics in Tucson. It was in May. It was like an oven. It was hot. We took an airplane. We had a great time. It was such a wonderful group of people. And I remember we also went to a desert museum in the middle of the day, and it was, you know, 100-something degrees, dry, walking around. Rick, I, and this other friend of his, we also went to an airplane museum where they have these giant airplanes we went through, and he loved that technology. It was just so fun. I've got a picture of him. Amelia Earhart, there's the plane that she flew, there's an example of it at this museum out in the desert. It's outside. And it has a picture of Amelia with the arms spread out like an airplane wing, like this. And so she's standing in front of that airplane. We recreated that with Rick. So I've got Rick standing there with his arms splayed out, like the wings of that airplane. But I just think the world of Rick. He was just a great person. He had a huge impact on people in that swim program. And he had a huge impact on me because of his dedication and his commitment and his sort of resolve and drive. And that's what I remember about him. And I guess there's one other thing. Rick was the kind of guy where you're talking to him, and I started out the same way. He had a little metal board, and he's doing this. I'm like, slow down. It's like another language. I've got to learn it. Slow down. And then he had the computer. But I would ask him a question, and he would say something. I kind of look at him. Half the things he would reply were so funny, and it would go right over my head. I'd be like, what? And you know, it'd take me a minute, and I'd be like, oh, that's what you meant. Or he was a really smart guy. And we just, what we need to do, we need to step up to his level, is what I think. Because Rick set a standard. And I love him dearly. And I think the other thing, I had no idea he had met Lisa, and he was just so blessed. I'm so happy for both of you that you were able to meet and have time together. But that's all. I just wanted to share that. I hope it was helpful. But I really feel blessed to have known Rick. He was just an exceptional person. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing that. We appreciate that. You know, John, as you were talking, that made me think of something I jotted down that Mosnick said. Is Dave Mosnick still here? You take off. Dave, yeah. You said Rick never had trouble finding a smile. And Moose, I thought that was a good way of saying it, you know. And he said he was the epitome of a person taking his disability and turning it into an ability. Mm-hmm. And I think you're hearing that today. He truly did turn it into an ability and a way to help others throughout the world. I know I was impressed as a younger guy when I told our manager Parks, Bill Wordy, he told us, hey, Rick's not here this week. He's in Michigan because he's doing a national. He's the distinguished lecture speaker at the event that he went to in Minnesota that year. And Leanne actually had that speech laminated up here. So this speech is here. I ask you to take a look at it before you leave. Just take a look and pass it around. It does show some of the eloquence in which you can write and articulate, so it was incredible. But yeah, I was impressed by that as a young guy as well. Brandon Wick, he wanted me to say something on his behalf. Mr. Wick said he just loved his positive attitude, and he never complained, and he stood up for other people who couldn't stand up for themselves, including sometimes Mr. Wick said he spoke on my behalf. If I didn't want to say something, he'd say it for me. I thought that was pretty awesome from Mr. Wick. Does anybody else have any stories? A complete open mic. Come on up.
So my name is Terry Liu, and I'm a relative newcomer to Rick's world. But I want to talk about his sense of humor and the patience that he had. So he and I met not too long after he and Lisa had gotten married, and I wagged him around. Transportation wise, I always told people I was the driver and Rick was the brains. But Rick would call me occasionally and say, well, I can't get my computer cables, can you come and help me? And I have a flexible schedule, so you can't mess it up. So I'd go by and I told Rick right from the beginning, I said, okay, so I got this figured out. you like to play charades, and I'm really crummy at it. So just use your board, please. But I laugh. We laugh together through a lot of things, and the biggest thing is that he knew his technology and he knew what needed to happen. And I'm an idiot because you know I milk cows all my life, and so you know technology's not so good. But so I told him, I says, okay, so well, you're going to use your brains, and I don't shake as bad as you do, so we'll get the job done. And he was really patient with me to do that. And the other thing I remember about Rick is how dedicated he was to the religious belief that he had as a member of the church, and I'm also a member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And as John Clark said, we know that Rick is in paradise. And I said, what's the awesome thing with Rick's passing is all of us are going to miss him. But when I think of Rick, I think, yep, Rick's running and he's really talking.
That's right. Thank you very much. All right, so as Leanne's getting ready to cue up this last song.
A lot more?
Yeah, absolutely.
Sorry.
Oh, no, thank you.
Hi, my name is Tracy Kovac. And I'm a speech-language pathologist. And at the time that I first met Rick, I was working at the Children's Hospital in Denver. And we developed a camp called the Talking with Technology Camp. You can figure it out. Rick came to this camp for, gosh, Lisa, like more than 40 years, right? And we've all talked about Rick's sense of humor and how he talked with us using spelling boards and all of that, and we've talked about how great he was with technology, but he was in fact a pioneer in the field of augmentative and alternative communication, using technology to have a voice output that many of us who couldn't spell as fast as he could understand. And he provided a great deal of mentorship to so many, many children who were like him, without a voice, but without a spirit, and without an understanding of language. So Rick contributed a great deal to our program, and we thank him. We thank Lisa for being a part of it when she came into his life, and we will forever remember him. And I'd like to just mention many of his friends, Ann McGann, Amy Fischel, Jill Tullman, so many of us who were a part of Rick's life who are not able to be here today to share this celebration. But we remember him and we think a great deal of him and appreciate him, as do hundreds of children throughout the United States and internationally who were a part of his mentorship. So once again, we remember and thank him.
All right, any others? Come on up. While you're coming up, I'll say, you know, we let them drive equipment too often, I think. there's a few stories where he's able to, our little Cushman vehicles, our little utility vehicles, we had him in there a few different times, and it was a blast, of course. He was grinning ear to ear many times. Mr. Drescher, I think you said somebody had him driving a dump truck over the hill at City Park, right? That had to be a hoot to see that once. Yeah, we had him in there a few times, for sure. But yeah, I think... I'll pass it on.
My story is kind of about vehicles, too. So my name's Jennifer Clark, also a speech-language pathologist. And I first met Rick at Talking with Technology Camp 20 years ago. And because I live in Fort Collins, I often got to take Rick and Lisa places, and one of the things that Rick did for me every year was come and speak. I teach a class at the University of Northern Colorado for aspiring speech-language pathologists, and in our field, there's a lot of SLPs, for short, who don't understand children who can't speak, right? Like, we're good at fixing R's and L's and things like that, but the completely nonverbal kids, we don't quite know what to do with. And so I just think Rick would come every year and speak to this group of aspiring clinicians and really like light their fire and show them what can happen when we do a good job. And I so appreciate that, and I so appreciate how far his reach was, because I've been teaching that class for 7 years, and in each class, there's 25 students. So just think of that math on top of everything he did at TWT and all of the professionals that he inspired there. I just think it's really amazing. But one of my funniest stories about Rick is maybe around 2012, I drove Rick and Lisa up to Talking with Technology Camp, which is out I-70 in Empire. And Rick kind of white-knuckled it the whole way. And when we finally got to camp, he looked at me for a while after we parked, and he said, "Thanks so much for the ride. I'm so glad Lisa couldn't see how you drove." And we had so many conversations with him in the passenger seat of my car, and he would be typing on his device, and I would try to be looking at what he's saying, and he would tell me to keep my eyes on the road. Such a fun person, and we had such a good time together always, and I'm going to miss him a whole bunch.
Very, very well done. Okay, so this third and final song is Rainbow Bridge by Kermit the Frog. And Lisa said it just kept running through her head because he loved this version so much. I mean, you see him lighten up about with this version too. So think of Rick as you're listening to this. Song. Lisa's probably going through your head just because it makes you think of him being a goofball and being funny and being trying to make you laugh, right? So Okay, so I want to thank Brenda and Leanne for helping Lisa get to this point today. I know many others are helping along the way, family and friends. Today, Molly and Jesse and Patrick, thanks for helping set up for today's event, helping us get to this. We also borrowed this unit from Kendra Boot, so this helps with this PA system for sure. But I'd like to invite you all to stay for a while, relax, have some refreshments, talk about Rick. Please, one at a time, come up to talk to Lisa to share stories and love on her for a little bit, okay? All right. So thank you all for coming on behalf of Rick Keeton. Thanks.